Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, Dan Friedell tells us about a debate among scientists concerning the intelligence of one kind of dinosaur. Dan Novak presents this week's education report, and John Russell has today's lesson of the day. But first, a look at pro-Palestinian protests happening at colleges in Europe. The pro-Palestinian protests at colleges across the United States have spread to campuses in Europe. On Tuesday, German police broke up a protest by several hundred pro-Palestinian protesters at Berlin's Free University, or FU. The protesters had put up about 20 tents and formed a human chain around the tents. Most of the protesters wore the familiar Palestinian head covering called a kufiya. The school's administrators said in a statement that the protesters had rejected any dialogue. They said some of the protesters tried to occupy classrooms and buildings. Administrators called in the police to clear the campus. This form of protest is not geared towards dialogue. An occupation is not acceptable on the FU Berlin campus, said University President Günter Ziegler. Police used a chemical spray against the protesters and carried some of them away after clashes broke out. At the University of Amsterdam in the Netherlands, Dutch police arrested about 125 activists as they broke up a pro-Palestinian demonstration camp. Amsterdam police said on the social media service X that their action was necessary to restore order after protests turned violent. There were no immediate reports of injuries. Video aired by the Dutch national broadcaster NOS showed police using equipment to knock down barriers. Video also showed officers carrying sticks and beating some protesters. The University of Amsterdam said in a statement that police ended the demonstration due to public order and safety concerns. The war between Israel and Hamas is having a major impact on individual students and staff, the statement said. We share the anger and bewilderment over the war, and we understand that there are protests over it. We stress that within the university, dialogue about it is the only answer. Students have also held protests or set up encampments in Finland, Denmark, Italy, Spain, France, and Britain. The protesters say they are against Israel's offensive in the Palestinian territory of Gaza, which started in late October 2023. Israel started the war in reaction to a terrorist attack by Hamas that killed about 1,200 people in southern Israel on October 7th. The war has destroyed much of the Palestinian territory of Gaza. Gaza's health ministry, which is run by Hamas, says about 35,000 Palestinians have been killed. In Finland, protesters from the Students for Palestine group set up an encampment outside the main building at the University of Helsinki. The group members said they would stay there until the university cuts ties with Israeli schools. In Denmark, students set up a pro-Palestinian encampment at the University of Copenhagen. The university said students can protest, but called on them to respect the rules on campus grounds. On their Facebook page, members of the activist group Students Against the Occupation said attempts to talk to the administration over the past 2 years about ending investment and ties in Israel have not gone anywhere. In Italy, students at the University of Bologna set up a tent encampment over the weekend to demand an end to the war in Gaza. Students organized similar protests in Rome and Naples, which were largely peaceful. In Spain, students have spent over a week at a pro-Palestinian encampment on the University of Valencia campus. Students set up similar camps on Monday at the University of Barcelona and the University of the Basque Country. In Paris, French police peacefully removed several students last week from the Paris Institute of Political Studies after they had gathered in support of Palestinians. Protests also took place last week at other universities in France, including in Lille and Lyon. Meanwhile, protests continue at colleges across the United States. Several universities have had to cancel their main commencement ceremonies, and students at the University of Michigan and Indiana University interrupted commencement ceremonies over the weekend. I'm Ashley Thompson.
A group of scientists has disputed a study published last year that estimated the intelligence of the dinosaur Tyrannosaurus rex to be similar to a baboon's. The group disputed last year's report from Susanna Herculano-Hausel at Vanderbilt University in Tennessee. It said the study did not use studies of reptiles like crocodiles and alligators to explain dinosaur brains. Zoologist Kai Kaspar is with the Heinrich Heine University in Germany. Kaspar was the lead author of the new study, published in the Anatomical Record. Speaking of dinosaurs like T-Rex, he said their neuron numbers were likely not exceptional, especially for animals of their body mass. But Herculano-Hausel stands by her research. She said her work studied the brain-to-body-size relationship of modern-day theropod relatives, such as ostriches and chickens. The brain size and number of neurons of those animals, she said, support her theory. A theropod is a group of dinosaurs that includes T-Rex. She said, only one issue is being disputed, what was actually the size of dinosaur brains. Even then, we're talking about the difference between a T-Rex brain being baboon or monkey-sized. Kaspar said his research group also considered modern birds. Reptiles are certainly not as dim-witted as is commonly believed, he said. Speaking of T-Rex, he noted, it was certainly a behaviorally sophisticated animal. Kaspar said he had additional concerns about Herculano-Hausel's research. One issue, he said, is that while humans, baboons, other mammals, and even birds have brains that fill the space protected by the skull, this is not the case for reptile species. He noted
The brain of reptiles fills only about 30 to 50% of the space. He also said, it is not known how many neurons or brain cells were present in dinosaur brains. Looking at living animals, we see that neuron counts are actually not a good indicator of intelligence in the first place, Kaspar added. Kaspar noted the study from 2023 assumed the brain filled the whole skull, which he said was certainly not the case. Scientists have been learning about dinosaurs for about 200 years, but much remains to be discovered. Thomas Holtz is the co-author of the new study. He studies dinosaurs at the University of Maryland. He said, estimating the intelligence of animals that lived over 60 million years ago is difficult. It would be nice if we could just estimate one number and unravel the whole complexity of an animal's biology and lifestyle, but nature isn't like that, Holtz said. He said T-Rex probably had an intelligence level somewhere between that of birds and reptiles. Many of our common assumptions don't really hold up when you examine what real animals do in the real world, he said. I'm Dan Friedell.
Haina Khan is a ninth grade student in Dhaka, Bangladesh. She struggled to keep attention on her studies last week as temperatures rose above 43 degrees Celsius in Bangladesh's capital. There is no real education in schools in this punishing heat, she said. Teachers can't teach, students can't concentrate. Rather, our lives are at risk. Khan is one of more than 40 million students who have been shut out of classrooms in recent weeks. Heat waves have forced school closures in parts of Asia and North Africa. As the climate warms due to the burning of fossil fuels, heat waves are lasting longer and reaching higher temperatures. Government officials and public health experts across the world are increasingly struggling with whether to keep students learning in hot classrooms. Either decision has impacts. About 17% of the world's school-aged children are already out of school, says the United Nations. But the proportion is much larger in developing countries. Test scores in the developing world are also behind developed countries. Heat could worsen inequalities by widening learning gaps between wealthy countries and poor nations in the tropics, experts told Reuters. It could even worsen inequalities between rich and poor areas in wealthy countries. Sending children to hot schools can also make them sick. Earlier this spring, heat-related school closures in South Sudan affected over 2 million students. Temperatures rose to 45 degrees Celsius there in late March. Thousands of schools in the Philippines and in India closed schools in late April, impacting more than 10 million students. Last week, Cambodia ordered all public schools to cut 2 hours off the school day to avoid the peak heat at midday. Bangladesh has debated whether to close schools for about 33 million students. Temperatures there are rising to dangerous levels. Many Bangladeshi schools don't have fans, the ventilation is not good, and they do not provide good insulation, said Shumon Sengupta. He is Bangladesh country director for the nonprofit organization Save the Children. Even if students continue attending classes during heat waves, their education is likely to suffer. High temperatures slow down the brain's functions, lowering students' ability to remember and process information. A 2020 study found that American high schoolers performed worse on standardized tests if they were exposed to higher temperatures in the year leading up to the exam. The research was published in the American Economic Journal. It found that a 0.55 Celsius degree warmer school year reduced that year's learning by 1%. Schools with air conditioning did not feel those same effects, said study co-writer Josh Goodman. He is an economist at Boston University. Goodman and his research partners found similar learning results tied to heat when they looked at standardized test data in other countries. When students in these places experience a year with more heat, they appear to have learned less, he said. Other research suggests high heat in the tropics can also impact a child's education even before birth. Children in Southeast Asia, exposed to higher-than-average temperatures in utero and early in life, received fewer years of schooling later in life. That information comes from a 2019 study in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. Goodman said as the world warms, already hot countries that become extremely hot countries will suffer more than cooler countries. Climate change will widen the learning gaps between hot and cool countries, Goodman said. Some developed countries are trying to find solutions to the issue. In March, the U.S. Agency for International Development, USAID, announced it would build 30 heat-resilient schools in Jordan by 2026, a USAID spokesperson said. Heat-resilient buildings can remain comparatively cool in very hot weather. USAID said it would spend $8.17 million on the schools. The schools would have special cooling systems and air conditioning. The number of days that schools are closed for extreme heat has been increasing in the United States. Few countries record such data. In Bangladesh last year, schools were closed for 6 to 7 days, said Save the Children's Sengupta. But this year, they are saying it might be closed for 3 to 4 weeks, he said. May is often the hottest month in South Asia. I'm Dan Novak.
Dan Novak is with me now to discuss today's education story. Hi, Dan. Welcome.
Hi, Ashley. Great to be here.
Today's report was about how extreme heat is closing schools and widening the education gap. First, what does the word gap mean? And second, what is an education gap?
Sure. A gap is a break in space in an object or between two objects. Gap also means a difference between two people, views, or situations. So when we talk about an education gap between poor and wealthy countries, it means that poor countries do not perform as well in school. Those students are not learning as much as students in wealthier countries. And so there's a gap in learning and performance. We also talk about education gaps between white and black students in the U.S., or graduation gaps between boys and girls.
And how exactly can heat worsen the education gap?
Well, as we saw last week in Southeast Asia, millions of students could not go to school because it was too hot. So in poor countries where schools do not have air conditioning, kids are going to be missing school more often. And missing school, of course, is not good for learning. Beyond that, extreme heat affects the brain. It's harder to think and learn when it's so hot. There's also an education gap between rich and poor areas within countries. I did a story a few weeks ago about ventilation problems in American schools, and poorer schools are more likely to have bad ventilation. Add in extreme heat, and that's going to make problems worse.
All right. Thanks so much for coming on the show today, and thank you for your report.
You're welcome, Ashley.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
In this next report, Dan Novak tells us about research that explored the genetic data of many kinds of flowering plants. We learn about the history and development of flowering plants, plants that are very important for human survival. Pay careful attention to the word aquatic. We will talk more about the term after the report.
Flowering plants are very important to Earth's ecosystems. They are necessary for life on Earth. Flowering plants are also called angiosperms. They are the largest and most diverse plant group. Flowering plants include corn, wheat, rice, and potatoes, to maple, oak, apple, and cherry trees. New research based on genome data for 9,506 species of flowering plants provides the deepest understanding yet of their evolutionary history. The research explains how angiosperms appeared and became widespread during the age of dinosaurs. It also offers explanations for how such plants have changed over time. The team of scientists created a new tree of life for angiosperms. A tree of life is a tool that biologists use to see the evolutionary relationships among plants, animals, and other life forms. Their new tree of life covers 15 times more kinds of flowering plants than the closest comparable study. It is a massive leap forward in our understanding of plant evolution, said William Baker. He is a plant expert with the Royal Botanic Gardens, Kew, in London. He is senior writer of the research study, Angiosperms are plants that produce flowers and produce their seeds in fruits. They are made up of about 330,000 species. About 80% of the world's plants are angiosperms. They include, among others, all the major food crops, grasses, most large-leaved trees, and most aquatic plants. Their closest relatives are the gymnosperms, a group that came before them on Earth. The study identified two periods of diversification among angiosperms. The first one occurred about 150 million to 140 million years ago, during the Mesozoic era. At that time, 80% of major angiosperm species arose. The next one happened about 100 million years later, during the Cenozoic era, after the extinction of the dinosaurs and the rise of mammals. That period saw decreasing world temperatures. Baker said angiosperms are more successful at reproducing than gymnosperms. Gymnosperms and angiosperms both have seeds. But the flowering plants have enclosed seeds that protect them from dehydration. This permits them to survive in a wider range of environments, from deserts to Antarctica. They also evolved the flower, a structure that permitted them to form relationships with animal pollinators, especially insects. Gymnosperms usually depend on the wind for pollination. Angiosperms evolved a high diversity of fruit types, permitting effective seed spread. Flowering plants provide most of the calories that humans eat, from grains to fruits to vegetables. They are sources of many of our medicines and hold potential solutions to global challenges such as climate change, biodiversity loss, human health, food security, and renewable energy, Baker said. The study could help scientists better understand disease and pest resistance in angiosperms, and the research could help find new medicines. Alexandre Zuntini is a Royal Botanical Gardens botanist and a lead writer of the study. He said that some plant lineages may hold chemical compounds or even genes that can be useful for survival of our species. I'm Dan Novak.
Before the report, we asked you to pay careful attention to the word aquatic. Can you remember when you heard it? You heard the term used in a list of plant types. Let's listen again.
About 80% of the world's plants are angiosperms. They include, among others, all the major food crops, grasses, most large-leaved trees, and most aquatic plants.
Aquatic is an adjective. It means living in or near water. We spell aquatic like this. A-Q-U-A-T-I-C. Aquatic can be difficult to pronounce. It has three different vowel sounds. A, A, I. We can study these vowel sounds by breaking the word into three parts. Let's start with the last vowel sound, I. Repeat after me. Tick. 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 Now let's add our middle vowel sound, A. Repeat after me. Qua tick. Qua tick. Qua tick. And finally, we can add in the first vowel sound and say the entire word. Aquatic. 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 There are a group of commonly used nouns that English speakers often use after the adjective aquatic. As you might expect from the term's connection to water, many of the nouns relate to the natural world. So you are likely to hear terms such as aquatic environment, aquatic organisms, aquatic animals, or like you heard in our report, aquatic plants. Aquatic is a term that is somewhat specialized. Still, it is useful to know, especially if you have an interest in the environment or biology. And that's the lesson of the day. I'm John Russell.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.